Hi, I'm Nick Adman.
And I'm Kyle Marsh.
And we're program managers in Azure Identity Engineering. And in this video, we'll talk about the basics of modern authentication. Kyle, how about you get us started?
Sure. So let's start with an app. So what the app needs to do is it needs to first off find out who the user is. That also tells the app who's if the user is allowed to use the application or not. And then the second thing for most applications is they need to access a resource or call an API. Now, the big difference with modern authentication is that the application doesn't do any of the authentication itself. It contracts that out, if you will, to the identity provider, in this case, Microsoft Identity. So instead of a developer having to keep up with all the latest ways that you need to authenticate nowadays, we definitely need the world to start moving to passwordless. Things like MFA are terribly important today. In order to do that, you do a lot of work as a developer to chase all that. Instead, we're just going to ask the identity provider, Microsoft Identity, to do that for us.
Right. So let's talk about how the app uses Microsoft Identity. So first of all, the app is going to request an ID token from Microsoft Identity to authenticate the user, and then it's going to request an access token in order to get authorization to call a protected API on behalf of the user. And in this case, that would be within Microsoft Graph. So first of all, it authenticates the user, which is about figuring out who the user is. And then second of all, gets authorization, which is about getting permission to call a protected API on behalf of that user. And with modern authentication, both of these processes happen over shared web surface. So Kyle, what does that process look like?
Sure. So by standard, what has to happen is a web surface is made available to the for a private conversation between the user and Microsoft Identity. The developer of the application has no visibility into this, and this is important because then they don't have access to what the user's name and password is or what have you. Also, since it's on a web surface, that allows us as the identity provider to do any kind of authentication needed. So it might be username and password, that might include an MFA, it could be a FIDO key, it could be true or passwordless. So the fact that we have this private conversation on a web surface allows the identity provider to support any kind of authentication that the administrator or the user needs.
Yeah, and as a result of that private conversation that happens between the user and Microsoft Identity, artifacts like session state or cookies get left on the user's machine, and that enables what we call single sign-on. So with single sign-on, the user enters their username and password or their credentials, they authenticate one time, and the next time that the application makes the same authentication or authorization request, because those artifacts are already on the machine, it can happen silently in the background. So the user doesn't get a prompt, they don't have to re-enter their credentials or redo MFA or any of that. And it works for that one application, but it also works for every application that uses Microsoft Identity on that same shared web surface. So the user signs in once and they get access to all those applications, which is a great user experience, but it's also a security feature because when users get habituated to entering their username and password frequently, they tend to do it more quickly without thinking about it. But when you have single sign-on enabled, you get prompted less frequently to enter your credentials. You tend to be more cautious and think more about it before you do so. From a developer perspective, it's just important to think about using a shared web surface so that other applications can take advantage of single sign-on as well. So the simple case here would be with a web browser. The web applications that are all running in that same web browser have a shared web surface, which is the browser, so they can all share that single sign-on experience. With mobile development, it's a little bit more complicated. We see people using embedded web views to get more control over the experience, but when you use an embedded web view, you're opting not to use single sign-on. So we would recommend that you use the system web browser or MCEL mobile libraries to enable authentication or authorization so that you get that single sign-on enabled with that. All right, Kyle, so what happens once the user is authenticated?
So once the user's passed whatever authentication has to happen, your application will first receive an ID token. So we're going to talk about OpenID Connect in terms of what this ID token. By standard, OpenID Connect dictates the format of this token. It's something called a JOT, a JWT, or JSON Web Token. And it has three components. The first component is a signature area. It tells us how the token has been signed. And the bottom section is the signature itself. It's very important. So now we know that no one has tampered with this token from the issuer to the application. So we can trust that the information in the token is from the actual issuer of the token. Inside the body, the middle section of a JOT token, we have information that I sometimes refer to as housekeeping, but it is very important information. First off, the issuer has to be from an identity provider that the application trusts. That's the identity provider that it originally asked to have to do the authentication in the first place. The audience claim, the AUD, these name attribute pairs, by the way, are referred to as claims. And the name of the claim, the AUD, for example, here, is again dictated by the OpenID Connect standard. So AUD stands for audience, and this identifies that this token's audience is this application. You would never want to use a token that was not issued specifically for your application or API. So you always check that the audience is, in fact, your software. And then the next three fields, claims here, are all about the lifespan of the token. When does it expire? When was it issued at? And when should you not use it before? This dictates the time frame for which this token is valid. A JOT token is valid until it passes out of its time frame. So it's valid for an hour if it's issued for an hour, or 2 hours, or what have you. So these time fields really make up the checking of how long a token is really good for. And then finally, of course, you actually get information about the user themselves. So again, based on standard, there's something called the subject claim, the SUB. This is a unique identifier for this user, for this application only. So if you were concerned that applications were sharing information about the users that you didn't want them to, you would want the application to only get the subject claim and nothing else. As opposed to, for example, our OID, the object ID, and TID, the tenant ID claims, these represent this identity forever. So as long as this identity exists, the same object ID and tenant ID will be given to applications, and every application will get that same pair. So if you're looking for a long-lived key, this is a great choice there. Now, we also get information about the user, like in this case, their name and their preferred username. This will help you say, for example, in this case, hi, Abe, in the application. But it's important to remember that you shouldn't be using these as keys, because these attributes of the user tend to change. People change their names, they change their email addresses, etc. So if you're looking for a great thing to key your data from, look at something like either the subject or the object ID and tenant ID.
Yeah, and so along with the ID token, that this app is also requesting an access token so that it can be authorized to call a specific API. And the identity provider will provide that authorization to the app by sending an access token back to the app. So just like with ID tokens, if the app doesn't receive the access token, the app is not authorized to call the API. But differently from ID tokens, there's no standard that specifies the format of an access token. So you might look at this blob and see that it is a JOT token, but your app should never decode or look into an access token. And the reason is that these tokens are based on a private contract between Microsoft Identity and the API implementer. So the format, the contents, and the encryption of an access token could change at any time. And if your app depends on that access token, it could be broken if it changes to any of those occur. So like I said before, access tokens are used to authorize the app to call specific APIs. And here, the Microsoft Graph API requires authorization, and we have an access token for Microsoft Graph. And when the app makes a call to a protected API, which in this case is Microsoft Graph, it sends the access token as a bearer token in the authorization header of the HTTP request. And then the API needs to validate the JOT signature and extract the claims. So it validates the audience and the lifespan of the token, and uses the other claims to determine how to respond to this request. So once that's done, the API will return the result of the API call to the app. But access tokens only have one audience claim, which means that they can only be sent to one protected API. So Kyle, what happens when the app needs to call multiple APIs?
Well, what we do is basically go through the entire process again, but this case we're going to go for a different API. So let's start from where we had before. We have our application that was going to call Microsoft Graph. That's our red token. So I have a token that allows the application to call Microsoft Graph. Now I need to acquire another token, another access token, to have this application be able to call the catalog API here. So we repeat the process. We go off and ask for an access token from Microsoft Identity. That private web service pops up, but there are the artifacts. So no actual conversation with the user has to take place. In fact, we have an API that says, just do this silently if you can. So we don't actually prompt the user. They don't see anything. The artifacts take care of the state. We understand that the user's already authenticated. Now, we may need to ask the user, do you want this application to also access your information in the catalog API? But assuming that the consent's been granted, we're just going to get the same process. We're going to get a different token now for the other API. Now, when you use something like the MSOL libraries, they manage these tokens for you. So they know when you say, I need a token, they know whether you already have one, they cache them, they refresh them, et cetera, all automatically. So when I make that call to the catalog API, I just say, I need a token for the catalog API, and it will be provided to the application. Same thing happens as before. We provide that access token as the authorization bearer token on the API request. While the application hasn't looked at that access token, the API does. It makes sure that it has all the right claims and information in the token to allow them to go ahead and return the results of that API back to the application. So these are the basics of what modern authentications are. The real key here is that the primary transaction is simply an application requests a token from the identity provider. Now, you also have to make those token requests on a shared web surface so that everyone can participate in single sign-on. So don't go to any embedded web views if you can. The application will get an identity token that they can use for themselves to identify the user. And if they're going to call an API that's protected, that requires authorization, you'll get an access token for each of those APIs. Never look at that access token as the application, but an API implementer does look at the token, does validate the token, and determine from the details in the token, the claims in the token, how that API should actually work. So we heartily recommend, of course, using an identity provider, not just because it saves you a lot of work, but the amount of effort and work that happens behind the scenes to make sure that only the right users and right applications get these tokens is really large and immense. So this is something you definitely want to, especially in today's environment, hand off to a identity provider like Microsoft Identity so you can really secure your applications based on that.
Great. And with that, that's it for our session on the basics of modern authentication. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.
Thanks.